Speaker of the House of Representatives, Femi Gbajabiamila, says the Ninth National Assembly is irrevocably committed to protecting the interest of the people through diligent discharge of its legislative duties. The speaker said this on Sunday in Lagos while speaking at the Gbaja 2019 end-of-year grassroots empowerment program. Gbajabiamila said criticism that the Ninth Assembly is a rubber stamp to the executive was not fair, saying the fact that the legislature was on the same page with the executive on issues of national interest did not make it a rubber stamp. The speaker added that he, like his colleagues in the National Assembly, was not elected to fight the executive and that lawmakers would disagree with the executive if there was the need to do so. And now, Jide Ologu, a legal practitioner, joins us in the studio to take a look at this. Thank you very much for joining us on the news.
You're welcome.
What's your take on the issue of the Ninth Assembly being a rubber stamp of the federal government?
You know, the word rubber stamp was coined to reflect the fact that you must concede to anything presented before you. And if Gbajabiamila said that they would rather be a rubber stamp than fight the government, the executive, I think he's making reference to what happened in the 8th Assembly, where the legislative arm and the executive arm appeared to be at loggerheads. For example, the 32 billion loan that the executive just represented, that is about to be approved by the National Assembly, was presented during the 8th Assembly, but was thrown out. And even the President of the Senate has said that anything that comes from the President, they are okay with it. But having said that, Gbajabiamila was making reference to the fact that they have not been elected to go and fight the executive, and that they will focus on delivering to the people, and that is where my own interest is. I mean, he made this statement as the grassroots empowerment program, and I would like him also to probably take a stroll around his grassroots constituency without his escort and security and see what the people are going through. They have been elected to represent the people, all right? And again, I think the journalist just picked that aspect of his statement, because what he was actually saying is that it's not that they will concede to everything coming from the executive arm, but that from time to time, the checks and balances will be there. And again, for those who may want to wonder why he made such a statement, you must go back to what it took him to secure that office. He almost crawled on his knees.
Yes,
so
indeed.
For him now to confront the executive arm may not be something healthy for him. But by and large, I think Nigerians need to benefit from the separations of power, from the deliverables of governance, because it's all about enhancing the fortunes of the people. And we have the separation of power between the executive, the legislative, and the judiciary. And none of them should appear to be dominating the others.
But by and large, the Ninth Assembly has been on for a little bit, enough time for us to like make a fair comparison between the Ninth Assembly and the Eighth Assembly and the relationship with the executive. Now we're hearing we're not meant to fight the executive, but we do know that the last assembly had not so, you know, paddish kind of relationship with the executive. What's your assessment of the relationship comparing the 8th and the 9th Assembly with the executive?
It appears to be a fluent relationship with this 9th Assembly, with the President, unlike the 8th Assembly. But that also is dangerous. For example, perhaps if it were to be under the 8th Assembly, our President would not have gone to Egypt to announce that Africans can come into Nigeria and receive visa on arrival, which the National Assembly is questioning now. But I think the executive also has this impression that, oh, these are our people. Anything we present must fly. And that is why the interest of the people must be the driving force. How can we bring back prosperity? Because in testing that fluency of relationship is also the latest trend now of budgeting about 37 billion naira to renovate the National Assembly.
Yes, I was actually going to ask you about that.
And yet, we have back roads in Nigeria that the same National Assembly requested that the federal government should declare state of emergency on our roads. We have the infrastructural deficit. We have the poverty in the land, about 100 million to be moved away from poverty.
Well, yes, these issues will be consistent. I mean, going by what we have, there will always be issues, problems to be fixed. But that does that also negate the need to give our public establishments the befitting face look of the African giant, so to speak?
It is not befitting. Why are they sitting there? Let's ask basic questions. It's like your house roof is leaking. You are not fixing it and you are painting the house. It doesn't make economic sense. You see, you must attend to the problems of the people. You see, a good government is out to synchronize the people, to ensure unity, ensure prosperity, not in absolute terms. And we can see the consequences coming now. Because sometimes when you fail to embark on self-evaluation, then those who care outside your borders will start helping you to evaluate your progress. You recall that it was not Nigeria that came up with the fact that we are now about 200 million, talking about our population. It was the United Nations. Now the US is also letting us know that we are drifting into gross abuse of the rule of law, that we are drifting, we are under watch now, classified as a terrorist nation. So these are all the issues. And the essence of having a government in place, it's in our constitution.
Okay,
to protect the people, provide for the people, create an enabling environment.
Apparently, you're not very satisfied with your performance so far, but they still have some time. Do you see them being better in the year coming?
If they have governance wisdom, they should perform. Because where you allow poverty to prevail, even the prosperous are threatened. So the best you can do is create a wider spectrum of peace, of security, of prosperity, so that your own prosperity, you can enjoy it. And that is why our greatest problem in this country now is insecurity. And for some of us, we think it's a deliberate positioning.
Indeed.
Because
if we dig deeper,
it is serving the interests of some political gladiators who are ambitious and think that the fastest and best way to secure their position is to intimidate the people and mobilize a group that will support that agenda. But we are saying globally, the world is moving towards prosperity, and that is what Nigeria deserves.
Thank you very much for your thoughts on the news.